all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, a pause, or anything they got. Now all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, a pause, or anything they got. Now
listen to the top where the little bird sings, and the melodies and the high notes ringing, and the hood owl cries over everything, and the blackbird disagrees.
Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day, when the little duck quacks and he's on his way, and the otter hasn't got much to say, and the porcupine talks to himself.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
Dogs and the cats, they take up the middle, where the honeybee hums and the cricket fiddles, the donkey brays and the pony neighs, the old great badger sighs.
Listen to the bass, it's a one on the bottom, where the bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with the big to-do, and the old cow just goes moo.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Simple song, a little song everywhere, by the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear, the dopey alligator and the hawk above, the sly old weasel and the turtle dove. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir.
Continuing the readings, the stories of David. And today's episode comes from 2 Samuel chapter 11, the last couple of verses, and then the first part of chapter 12. When Bathsheba heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. Then after the time for mourning was over, David sent someone to bring her to the palace. She became David's wife and they had a son. The Lord was angry at what David had done, and he sent Nathan the prophet to tell this story to David. A rich man and a poor man lived in the same town. The rich man owned a lot of sheep and cattle. But the poor man had only one little lamb that he had brought and raised. The lamb became a pet for him and his children. He even let it eat from his plate and drink from his cup and sleep on his lap. The lamb was like one of his own children. Then one day someone came to visit the rich man, but the rich man didn't want to kill any of his own sheep or cattle and serve it to the visitor, so he stole the poor man's little lamb and served it instead. David was furious with the rich man and said to Nathan, "I swear by the living Lord that the man who did this deserves to die. And because he didn't have any pity on the poor man, he will have to pay four times what the lamb was worth." Then Nathan told David, "You are that rich man. Now listen to what the Lord God of Israel says to you. I chose you to be the king of Israel. I kept you safe from Saul and even gave you his house and his wives. I let you rule Israel and Judah, and if that had not been enough, I would have given you much more. Why did you disobey me and do such a horrible thing? You murdered Uriah, the Hittite by having the Ammonites kill him so you could take his wife. Because you wouldn't obey me and took Uriah's wife for yourself, your family will never live in peace. Someone from your own family will cause you a lot of trouble. And I will take your wives and give them to another man before your very eyes. He will go to bed with them while everyone looks on. What you did was in secret, but I will do this in the open for everyone in Israel to see. David said, I have disobeyed the Lord God. Yes, you have, Nathan answered. You showed you didn't care what the Lord wanted. He has forgiven you and you won't die, but your newborn son will. Then Nathan went back home. And so we come to part three of our theme, Giant Falls from Grace. No, Giant Falls to Grace. There's quite a difference.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. How I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling someday for a crown. Then you'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down.
I recently bumped into the phrase scandalous grace. It was a title given to an article I was reading. What could it mean? Grace that offends? Grace that pushes us the wrong way? Grace that somehow is taken the wrong way? Grace that rocks the boat? I love telling the story of the day I caused a scandal in school chapel. This took place in my first year here at St. Paul's. The topic I was opening up was the topic of grace. My aim was to highlight how our God is a God of grace. He gives us such undeserved love. My take was to say that and to show that grace just isn't fair. I set up a couple little competitions and asked for some volunteers, challenging them to have a go and try and win. Twice there was a clear winner. I had a prize to give, but I gave it to the loser. Eventually, I shared some of the prize with the winner as well. My point, trying to illustrate that grace just isn't fair. God gives us his grace and love even when we fail. The next day, I was called up to the principal's office. Mike, I have received a complaint from a parent that you have been teaching our children that it's okay to be unfair. That led to a great little conversation with a parent, and we ended up making it quite clear that the topic was in fact about God's grace. The grace shown to David, despite the scandal in his life, is more than simply unfair. This is giant grace. It's a giant fall from grace, a giant fall to grace. And some would call this scandalous grace. Nathan meets David. He knows about the scandal. David's a royal whose career has been going magnificently. Privately, in his own home life, it's a mess for David. When you're a royal, especially when you are a successful royal, it's possible to get away with anything. It's possible to get away with murder if you have to, if you want to. So scandalous grace is the way Nathan takes God's grace to the scandal. While David can get away with murder, God knows. And Nathan's job was to tell David that God knows. God knows and he acts. Let's watch and see how scandalous grace works. Now Nathan, the name Nathan is the Hebrew verb also for to give. So who is this guy? What's it take to go to the most powerful man on earth and tell him that God knows? It's a little bit like when an ordinary little people who work at ground level are so frustrated that they organise the march to Parliament House and demand to see the Premier or the Prime Minister to give him or her the message that something is not quite right. A great injustice has taken place. Little people who live at ground level sometimes have to tell the most powerful person in the state what it is that their leader seems to have lost sight of. Have you ever felt a strong conviction and a need to take it to a person who is further up the food chain of our society? Most of us back away. Who am I? Who am I to speak up about this? Well, Nathan here is able to confront his king. Nathan confronts David with a story about a little lamb. It's a powerful little story. Naturally, David is outraged at such an obvious injustice, and he has the power to change this behaviour. No one is going to get away with this kind of abuse of power and wealth on his watch as the royal leader of this young and powerful country. In his blindness, he didn't see the trap. Of course, he's just shot himself in the foot. Now, David is often given credit for the hymn book in the Bible, known as the Book of Psalms. Now, I've no doubt that he wrote quite a few of the old songs that we have in our Bible. But one of the legacies of David's reign as king is that he founded what we might call a university of worship music. Most of the Bible Psalms were written by people who attended the university which David set up in order to enrich the worship life of his country. The most famous song to come out of this worship school is Psalm 23. It's a song about sheep. And later on, this song inspires Jesus to give us one of his greatest parables about the Good Shepherd and the lost sheep. One of his great I am sayings in John is, I am the Good Shepherd. It's a famous picture of who he is and what he does. The richness of this picture is appreciated even more when we hear Nathan's illustration that confronts King David. A little lamb is stolen from a poor family by a powerful person who has many sheep of his own. The stolen sheep is so precious to his poor family that it lives in their home. This lamb is like one of the family. The crime in Nathan's parable is that the lamb is slaughtered and the injustice is massive. And so David is confronted with his mistake. He now knows that God knows. And from our perspective, we can now see how Nathan's parable is also a parable of Jesus, the Lamb of God, killed because of the poor choices made by all of humanity, the sin of the world. This morning, we're just going to consider another famous psalm of David, often linked to how he feels when Nathan confronts him. And so we'll enjoy the words in the form of a song of Psalm 51. You'll see the words in a moment. And when Jesus becomes that lamb for us, we are confronted with the scandals that wreck our lives. But more powerfully, we meet with God's grace. God sent this lamb into our lives because of the injustices that we are responsible for, as well as the injustices we are victims of. Jesus' life is taken from him because of it. This is scandalous grace. And it's such a powerful story. This story can be found in the story of each of our lives. Now, last week, in fact, the last couple occasions we've been considering this epic story of David, I asked you to consider part two of this series, Giant Falls to Grace. You will recall that David began his royal climb to power and privilege when he killed a giant who represented the enemy of David's community. David became a giant on the world stage with power and wealth and economic and military like Israel never had before and would never have again. David is the first in a dynasty of kings. God's salvation of our world, David's line leads to King Jesus. Jesus was never a royal king or a king over political or military power. Far greater is our divine king. God, with all his power in the universe, Jesus is God whose strongest display of power is the way he loves us, his people, and he is the lamb whose life is sacrificed. What emerges from this story is God's giant-sized grace. It's grace that can handle giant-sized scandals. It's grace that perseveres with the one who has failed. Jesus is the bottom line of Nathan's word to David. What a story. And you'll appreciate this as we now go and look at that psalm that David wrote after Nathan confronted him.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, I'm above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified and laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and above all.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.